Hello everyone, my name is Hadil and today we're going to talk about data visualization and processing. I wanted to talk about data visualization and processing because I want to do a mini series on importing files into processing. So Excel sheets, text files, images, and other things that we can import and see what we can do with them. So for today's video, I'm going to talk about CSV files and how we can import them and use that to visualize its data in processing. The first thing that you need to have in order to do this with me in the video is to have a CSV file. A CSV file, or a CSV, stands for comma separated values, and it acts like a table, but it looks a little bit different. And I'm going to keep this file in the description down below so you can use my data to do this with me if you want, but you can do it with your own data. It's the same process. The only thing that you're going to change is knowing what values to map if your visualization requires mapping the values to the screen. So I exported my Goodreads library. Goodreads, if you didn't know, is basically a website where you can keep track of all the books that you have, the books that you're currently reading, when did you read them last, and how many times have you read them. It has lots of great data as you plot them, and you can then grab all of that or export that data to visualize it if you want, or to just keep it. Now we're going to use it to visualize some data in processing. So I cleaned it up and I only left the titles of the book, the author, additional authors if I ever needed them, but I'm not going to use these two for now. And then my rating, average rating of the book, just in case I wanted to compare the two. And then the number of pages, and then the date read, which is when I last read the book, and then year published and original publication year. So my version of the book, or my edition of the book, is this year published, and then the original publication year is when it's first published. I only have 102, so I cut down on some of them. I only left data that of books that I read from 2010 until this year, so 2021. So what I'm going to do after cleaning them up in Google Sheets, I'm going to download it. So I'll just go to File, Download, and then I'm going to download it as comma separated values, which is our CSV file. And then once that is downloaded, I can go to processing. And I don't know if this works in Windows, but just go to your file, your sketch file. So you have to save it. And then if I go to the file, I create a new folder. I'm going to call it data. Just like you do with images once you import them, I've done a code with me with images, and this is what I've done. And then I'm going to put this CSV file in there. I also am going to change the name just to Goodreads Library, so it's much easier for us to import. And now let's start. So when we opened our CSV file in Google Sheets, it looked like a table. So we can simply use table or the table data type in processing to get all of that information from there. Let's create a table. I'm going to call it table because we're not going to have multiple ones. And then in here, inside of the setup function, I'm going to initialize that or load the table. Load table takes a string, which is the file name. And our file name is called goodreads_library.csv. And I'm also going to add another argument to the load table. These are optional, but usually when we create tables, we have headers for them. If you know exactly what your table has, so let's say you only have two columns that you want to visualize, maybe you don't need the headers, then don't put them. You can just omit that from the file, and you don't have to add these optional arguments, but since I have my headers because I do need them, I'm going to add this optional arguments where I say that my file has headers. So now it knows that the first line in our file is actually the table's header. if you view this right now, you can see it, it's a table, but if I open it in a text editor, then I can see that it's comma separated. So title, comma author, comma additional. So we know that it's a CSV file. And the first line over here is are the headers of the table. And that's why I added this optional one. Next, we're going to look through this table using a for loop. And we're not going to use the regular for loop. I'm going to use the one that I usually use with array lists, and that's a for in. So for table row, and I'm going to call it row because when you're looping in a table, you're going to go through every row. Each row is of type table row. So that's why I said for table row, and then I called it row in table dot rows. So this is how you can get the rows of your table. And if you ever feel like whatever I'm giving you is not sufficient for your data, let's say in this, then please do visit the reference page in processing. Now the website is even nicer and you get to filter things and search right in the website. So let's say I want things related to table. You can see that we have table and table row. So if I go to table and then I go down over here, you can see all of the methods for the table class. And if you feel like this is not enough either, then you can go to the processing table Java documentation. And in here, you can find even more methods. So if you look through this, it's a long list of methods that you can use. For now, we're only going to use a few of these. So let's get back to processing and let's go through the rows. So for the first row, or for the first column in any of the rows, I have a title, and this is what I'm going to need for this example. I know that the data type of that is a string, so I'm going to use string, and then I'm going to call it title. And you can grab the values from the rows by going through the row, and then there are methods that you can use, like getString to get all of the strings inside of the table in every row. And the string that you're going to put in here, or the value of the argument that you're going to put inside of getString, is going to be exactly what your header is. So for me, it's title with a capital T. So now it knows that it will grab whatever column that has title as its header. And then for the second one, I'm going to use a float, and that is going to be the rating. Actually, I'm going to use an int instead, because if you're putting your own rating, you don't have the opportunity in Goodreads to put a half rating. However, if you're grabbing the average rating, then that is a float, just keep in mind. Then row get int. So there are a bunch of these. If you go over here, you can see that there is get string and get float, get integer. So these are the values that you can grab. Get integer also takes a string, and it's going to be the title. So mine is my rating, and it's written like that. Let's look at the example that we are going to create. So if you can see, we have multiple books in three columns. So I know I'm going to use a table as well, or a grid. We have three columns and then the amount of rows it needs to cover all of the titles in three columns. But I don't know the number of rows, I only know the number of columns. So for now, I'm just going to set the number of columns. So for that, I'm going to create two integers, one for x count and one for y count. And then I'm going to create two floats for cell width and cell height. And then after the table, I'm going to set x count as 3. Y count is going to be table dot, or the row count. So I can get that by saying table dot get row count, and then divide it by x count. So 3. And then let's define cell width. Cell width is going to be width divided by the float of x count. And again, the reason why I convert this to float or cast X count into a float, because I want the calculation to be more precise. Cell height, height divided by float, Y count. And now because I don't have an index here, because I'm not doing a regular for loop. You can do a regular for loop if you want, but I'm going to just add an index up here that I'm going to call index, and it's going to go through all of the rows. So at the end of the loop, I'm going to increment that. So now we can use this to get our I and J values. So this is going to be index divided by Y count, and then J is going to be index modulo Y count. If you've noticed from my other videos or from my sine grids video, I've done whatever the value, the bigger values is, so the index here, modulo X count, and then I did index or whatever the value was for the loop, divided by X count. But this time I'm flipping it because I don't want it to go 1, 2, 3 to the side. I want it to go through the rows first. So the way you would do this is by flipping it, and instead of dividing by X count, you're going to divide by Y count. So it's the same concept, but it's flipped. And now we can get our X position for the corners of the grids and our Y position. So X position is going to be I multiplied by cell width, and Y position is going to be J multiplied by cell height. If you feel like this way of creating a grid is confusing, just go and watch my sine grids video and you'll be able to understand it, because I explain it a lot better in that video. And now just to check that everything is working perfectly, I can just use rectangles to test. So X position, Y position, and then cell width and cell height. And I can see the grid is perfect. Every cell is at its position. Now we only need to add the text or the titles of the book to my screen. So the way I can do this is by using the text method. The text method takes a string for its first argument, so that will be title, and then it takes an X position, so that's X position, and then a Y position, and it'll draw the text for us. So if I run this right now, we're not gonna see, or we're actually seeing something, but it's all in white, so I'm going to change that to black, or rather not here. However, because the text is drawn from the lower corner, then we're going to need to push it. So the way you can push it is by adding the cell height divided by 2. And now it's pushed to the top, but the other thing that you need to do is also add the text ascent to it. Divided by 2. Actually, I did divide it by 3. If you notice around certain areas, the text is too long that it's hiding behind the second column. So if I actually do no fill for this one, we can see that better. So as you can see, it goes beyond its column. A way we can fix that is by grabbing the title.length. So each time it loops, so each time inside of each row, I'm going to just call this S or whatever, and then I will grab the length of the text or of the string, and then I will check that the text width, which is another method that you can use to get the text width or how long the number of characters are in a string. So I can just use title, then cell width. So while the text width is greater than the cell width, then I want it to truncate that or get the substring. So I'll just do title equals. So the new title for that row is going to be a substring. And this is one of the methods from the string object. And it's going to go from 0 to whatever s is. So this is going to give a new value to title, and every time this is getting the length of that title, and then it's checking if it's greater than the cell width. If it is, then it's going to shorten it from 0 to the new length. And then I'm going to shorten that length every time. And then I'm going to check if text width of title is less than cell width, and only then can I draw the text. When I run this, we're going to see that we still have a problem with overlapping text. And the thing to fix this is by setting the text size. So if I set it to 16, then it fixes the issue. Now you can see that everything is cut to the cell width. So you don't have any overlapping text. I also like to add a little bit of margin. So I'm going to add 12 pixels to this. And I also want to show what titles are truncated. So I can do that by, after getting the substring of the title that is required to fit into that cell width, then I'm going to add 3 dots to that. And this way we can see everything is truncated nicely, and we can see what titles are shortened. Now let's color this by the rating. So for rating, I want to have a color of orange or red for anything below 2. And then for the average rating of 3, then I want to put a yellow color. And finally, for anything above 4-star rating, I want to have it as green. So I'm going to quickly just write down the colors that I have. So I'll call the first one top, and I'm going to give it this color. And then for mid, and then for bottom. Instead of having this as no fill, I'm going to give it a fill based on the different rating. So for the first one, I'm going to do the green one. If rating is greater or equal 4, I want the fill to be the top one. And then if rating equals 3, fill is going to be the mid color. And then if rating is less than 3, or you can do less or equal 2, it's all fine. I'll do the bottom. And you can also do if nothing is rated. So if you forget to rate something, or if you didn't rate a few of your books, then you can add another color for that, or maybe not add a color. And if you noticed, I have these weird symbols that used to be Arabic glyphs before I changed the text size. But as you change the text size, even the font itself changes. And I don't know, like, I'm not a font or a typeface expert, so I don't really know what this one is, but we're going to change that later in order to export our files. And then for the text, I'm going to keep it as green, as black. And now we can see our colors. Now I can get a view of what books I actually loved and what books I didn't by just looking at this. So something like this, the self-taught programmer, I didn't rate, and so it gave me red, even though it's a great book. So you can either go to your file and fix that, or you can simply just add another color, which is what I'm going to do. So if LSF rating equals 0, fill that with whatever the background color is, and I'm going to add that right now. Make sure that you check over here, and rating is greater than 0. And I also want to change the fill of my text. I'll just call it foreground color. And I don't want them all to have rectangles behind them. I just want the rectangle to show the rating, but not necessarily being a big part of the design. So I'm going to have it, and I'll do plus cell height divided by 2. just to push it down. And then I'm going to change the background color from white to the background color and remove the stroke. I also want to add margins to this. Not necessary, but I just like to add it. And then subtract it from the width. And then over here, push everything by the margin. And this allows us to see that there is another column that didn't fit into the three column because, as I said before, we need three columns and then whatever amount of rows that divides into three. So these two didn't divide well. You can either remove whatever books you don't want from your data and just make sure that your number of rows is divisible by three. But what's important here right now is just to show you how you can get the data in and use them to, and how to visualize them. Now, the final thing that we are going to do is export this. You can also add margins or bigger margins at the bottom. So you can say height minus a margin that is bigger down here, just so you can add legend or a title. You can do it up top over here. I do that all in Illustrator later. I just make all of this smaller and then add the legend and my title. However, for some projects, you're gonna need to do that beforehand. I'm gonna show you something first with the export, and then I'm going to show you how to fix it. So to export it to Illustrator, we're going to use the PDF library. So we can just import that from processing. And I'm going to just import everything. And then in here, I'm going to do begin record. And I'm going to give it a type of PDF. And the second argument is going to be the name of the file. So I'll just say data viz.pdf. And then we have to end the record as well. So I'm gonna do that after everything. And end record doesn't take any arguments. So if I run this, and I should have this over here. Now I have my PDF. This PDF I can open with Adobe Illustrator, and I'm going to have everything vectorized. So if I go to Adobe Illustrator or open with Adobe Illustrator, the first thing that I do is hit Command Option 7 or go from Object, Clipping Mask, and Release Mask. So I'm going to just click this one. And now I can delete the rectangle for the clipping mask. And you can see that processing saves whatever is outside of the screen as well. So these two are also saved. The only problem here that I have is that the text objects are outlined, so you cannot fix them. You cannot adjust the font. You cannot adjust anything related to text in Illustrator. The reason why this happened, or the reason why it outlined it, because the font that processing is using by default doesn't allow for the text mode model to export the text as text objects that are editable. So what I do is make sure that it says text mode model. Now, if I run this, it'll give us an error. And the error says use text mode shape with Processing Sans Pro. So this is the default font. Processing Sans Pro is what is being displayed or what it's saved in our PDF file. And so it wants us to change this to shape. Now, by default, text mode is actually model, but because we didn't state it before, it didn't give us an error and it just saved the PDF file. But now, because I stated that I want it to be this text mode, it gave me an error and it said that you'll have to use shape. But we can fix this by using a different font. And the way you can do it is by using pfont, and I'll just call it F. And then over here, we can say, or we can create a font. And create font can get any font from your system or from your computer that is visible to processing. So I know for sure that Helvetica is visible and it works. So for every project that you need the text to be editable when it comes to data visualization, the majority of the time you're going to need it to be editable because the fonts here are very limited or the system fonts are very limited. You'll have to use Helvetica most of the time just to export it. And then you have to set the size of the font. And then I'm going to use the text font over here. So I can just say text font and we're using VF. Now if I run this, okay, I misspelled Helvetica. I misspelled it very badly too. Okay, so this is how Helvetica is spelled. Now if I run this, it should work. Okay, so now we can see Helvetica is the font that is being used. And if I go over here, I can see that it saved it. The only problem is that if you're using Arabic or Arabic glyphs, like I did because I had a book that I read in Arabic, then it's going to go. So I would recommend that you go through your system font and find a font that works for the Arabic glyphs. But for now, it's hidden. So I'm gonna have to write it myself. Now I can open it with Adobe Illustrator. Okay. So now just release the mask. That's command option 7. And then I'm going to just delete those last ones. And then I'm going to just delete whatever that mask is. And one thing to note is that if you save this, it's going to save over your PDF. So if you want to not overwrite your original PDF, then just save as. And you can save it as an Illustrator file. But I'm going to just do this right now over the PDF. So if I hit one of the text, or you don't need to do this, you can go to Select and then Object, All Text Objects. So this way, you can go over here and you can choose whatever font you want. So I'm going to use this one from Adobe Fonts. Now it's time to change the color of these. So the reason why I chose these colors is because I didn't know if I wanted to change them later. However, the text doesn't really look visible because the contrast is really bad between some of the colors, like the yellow and this foreground color or the text color, which is a lighter yellow. But I still wanted to export it with these colors or with any random colors, just to show you that you can later recolor your artwork in Adobe Illustrator. So the way you can do this is by selecting everything, then you can just go to Edit, and then Edit Colors, Recolor Artwork. So I'm going to just use this one, and the new one looks like this, and it shows you the prominent colors over here. But if you go to advanced options, then this is what we're used to seeing when it comes to recoloring artwork. What's cool about this is now I can just grab the yellow and I can change it to whatever I want. So I can just make it a little bit darker so we can see it against that lighter yellow. I can also change it a little bit to an orangey color. And if I go to the red, I can also change that to whatever color I want. And lastly, maybe make the green a little bit darker, and hitting OK is just going to fix it. Also, for the ones that I didn't color because I didn't fix the data, I simply just added whatever colors I wanted for the rating that I had. And you can also, I just locked the background by hitting Command 2, and then I can just make this a little bit smaller. And you can put legends over here if you want. And my final results look something like this. So I fixed my data and then I added ratings where I didn't add ratings. And then I added a legend at the bottom down here. And I added a title for the visualization. Another two examples that I've created is this one. And this is just showing my 12 years of reading. My actual result looks something like this. It's nothing like the final result. And the final example shows my ratings across the years. So how many books did I rate 3 stars, or how many books I read in all of the years from 2010 to 2021 that had a 4-star rating, and which year is the best. So let's say in 2015, I rated 9 books 3 stars. And in 2013, I rated 6 books 5 stars. And this is something that you can do if you use string dictionaries. So this is another thing that I wanted to show you, or integer dictionary or int dictionary. But I usually use string. It's only for these two that I used int. And this is how the original data looks. This is very close to how the final result looks, but I still added a few things and I still fixed it. So if I go down here, or actually if I go, because I run this already, whatever I printed over here is my integer dictionary. So what I did is grabbed the year and the rating, and I made them the key for this dictionary. And then I checked if the integer dictionary, or if my dictionary, has the key. If not, then it adds 1, because I wanted to count the ratings for each year. And then if it did have the key, then I can just increment that. So what I get for 2021, of 5-star rating, I had only 1 book. For 2018, of 3-star rating, I had 1 book, and so on and so forth. And you can see that the 9 books I had in 2015 had 3 ratings. So what's cool about integer dictionaries or string dictionaries is that you can accumulate data like this to count stuff. So this is similar to what you would do in Jupyter Notebook with Python. If you've ever used Python for data analysis, then you would know this. We usually use pandas and NumPy to fix the data or to calculate things that we want from the data. And then we can filter it into a multitude of tables that we can later visualize. Also with the R language, if you've ever worked with that. This is the same thing. So integer or string dictionaries and integer dictionaries, just dictionaries in general, where they have keys and values, are ways to filter your data or to create a multitude of tables that you can use to visualize your data. If you like this, or if you find this really interesting, then I would recommend that you go to a website called Feltron.com, owned by Nicholas Felton, who does data visualization with processing. He has a project called the Feltron Annual, Annual Report. So it's called Feltron Annual Report. And every year from 2005 to 2014, he created visualizations using processing. I don't think all of them were using processing, but I think the latest ones used processing. So if, let's say, open 2013, which is one of my favorites, actually, then you can see that he visualizes his own data yearly using processing. He visualizes things on maps as well. So if you think this is a cool thing that you really want to get into, then I would recommend his Skillshare courses. He has 3 Skillshare courses on data visualization. One of them, he delves deeper into processing and shows you everything that he uses in order to visualize the data. And there are a multitude of things that he shows, like mapping your values, like I did over here in one of my files. So for this one, for instance, I mapped the years to the X position, and that's how I created this part. So if you're interested in that, you can go to his Skillshare courses. I'm not really paid to say any of that, because I took all of his 3 courses and I really love them, and I think they are courses that are worth looking at and taking. That's all I have for today's video. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll talk to you later.
Into your driveway, it's a Saturday night. You look like a million bucks wearing that dress I like. You're smiling, but there's something missing in your eyes. Girl, I can tell that you have something on your mind.